When it comes to the president, I was proud to see him once again disavow his association, talk about why he does not associate himself with these organizations, these hate groups. He did this back in March of 2016 with respect to David Duke. And he said, David Duke is a bad person. I disavow from David Duke. I disavow from the KKK. He did that in March of 2016. He gave a statement this weekend that wasn't strong enough for a lot of people because he did not name specifically these different hate groups.
Was just it like President.
Yes. Yeah, it was strong. Yes, it was strong enough for me because he came out and said hatred, bigotry, and violence have no place in our society in America. And that was true. And he was talking
but the
about many the hate
sides and not specifying groups.
You know what? When President Obama, after Charleston, came out right after Charleston 9 and gave his remarks, it was a very tempered response, and he did not go into details because he didn't know all the facts. He did not name all of those people by name, all those hate groups by name, and did not call that person who was a domestic terrorist, and we knew that he was, a white supremacist, a neo-Nazi, or a member of the KKK. He didn't do any of that, but he didn't receive the backlash. But President Trump did do that today. He did it, and afterwards, when Jim Acosta came and asked him about it again, he said, they have been disavowed. They have been disavowed. They have been disavowed.
Can I just say something real quickly, Brooke?
And the last point to this, Keith, I didn't interrupt you, is that I'm surprised that all of a sudden we want the President of the United States to be our bishop, our priest, our pastor. If you go back to past presidents, Bill Clinton, Richard Nixon for many instances, or if you go back to JFK, there have been huge examples of moral failure. So the President of the United States has never been someone that we look to be our moral leader. If you want a perfect person, if you want somebody who was beyond fault and repute, you can't elect Jesus Christ because he's the only one that was perfect.
This is a political leader.
I'm sorry to the other guests. I just have to say something about this. We have a president of the United States right now who started his political career by attacking the first African-American president with a racist birtherist attack, which he continued for 5 years. He started his political campaign by attacking Mexicans. And he started his ascendancy in the political campaign by attacking Muslims. He has a history of racism, and he's failed to repudiate this. This is unlike President Obama. I'm offended that you continue to go there, Paris. But the reality is that President Trump has not done enough, and I'm ashamed that you, as an African-American, Paris, will not say that.
Well, Keith, I don't need you to try to pull my black card. I am well aware of my blackness and don't need you to try to classify me as being one. I understand what racism is. Keith, don't go there. Do not go there. I know what it means to be a black man in this country. I know and I experienced racism on a regular basis by being a Trump supporter and by being a proud American who happens to be a Republican. I get racist comments about my family, about my mother, about my girlfriend, about my character every single day from black people, Keith. If you really want to get down to it, my family's from Georgia. Keith, let me finish. Guys. My family's from Georgia. We have members of our family that went missing because of the KKK taking them up. So don't come to me and tell me about what it means to be a black person in this country. I fought every day in the George W. Bush White House. Yes, Keith, let me finish.
I won't calm down because I will not be attacked
by you about my blackness because I happen to be a Republican and I listen to our president.
Paris, you've really gone off the rails here.
You're obviously very sensitive and defensive about this issue, Paris, because you have your own issues and demons to resolve. Get your guests under control.
Keith and Paris, just do me a favor. Just please
get them under control because I will not come on the show and be disrespected and have my authenticity.
You can disrespect African Americans every day when you come on the show.
Hang on, please.
And you don't represent them at all. You don't represent the 8% of the that voted for
this group. Guys, you're the spokesperson.
Guys,
I'm not their spokesperson, but I happen to be a black person who agrees with this president, and I'm proud that he stood up there and said what he said, denouncing the Klan, denouncing David Duke like he did in March, and denouncing
after
the hatred, bigotry, and violence.
It took him two days to denounce David Duke.
Take that conversation, have it off camera. I really would like to have a substantive conversation about.
Yeah, well, he better watch how he talks about me too.
I understand.
Paris, shut up, please, for God's sake. Why are you doing this?
Okay, so you're gonna let him tell me to shut up? No, but Kenny Kitchen, you know that the Simone Sanders day was a meltdown. Don't tell me to shut up on the show. This is preposterous, and you know
guys,
it.
Guys, please respect. Give me a minute. Joe, I know you've been listening to all of this. I know your eyebrows have been raising. How do you view how the as a conservative, you know, as a beloved member of the Republican Party, we've talked at length about that. How listening to the president, listening to this conversation on the show, this is where we are now in this country?
I think that the reality is that this is where we've been at as a nation for a very long time.
True.
So I don't think that this is necessarily something that is new. I think that for a lot of Americans, they're just finally realizing the fissures that have existed in this nation for a very long time. I listen to what just occurred right now. It's heartbreaking because, again, I look at both of you. You are my brothers. And regardless of what's happening right now in this country, that we have to find a way to fix these issues as brothers and not tearing each other down, not engaging in black-on-black intellectual crime in prime time. You know, so I understand that we get frustrated when people try to castigate us. You know, I get ridiculous things on Twitter the same way as you do, Paris. And I understand the frustration and the anger, but you cannot drive out hate with rage. You know, and so again, that we need to figure out a way that we can, as a nation, as people, as a community of people of color, as a nation of people that is the tapestry of all different ethnicities, figure out how we can, again, come together, hold hands, and do things differently. I think there are realities that we need to confront on the Republican side, as well as just as a nation. I think that when you have a president that habitually communicates in the language of hyperbole, when you contrast that with the statement that he made over the weekend, it becomes very difficult for people who have been marginalized, for people who do not necessarily feel like they have felt the warm embrace from this president, to believe that he is being sincere. That is just the outcome of what has transpired, for better and for worse. And so I think, again, ultimately, it's incumbent on us, those of us who have this platform, those of us who have been blessed with the opportunity to have input on issues that impact people's lives, to be able to sit down and say, what is our objective? And then say that there is not one path to get there, but then multiple forces from different standpoints can work together to get us to where we're trying to be as a society.
I want to add this.
Please, I think it's
important to note, you know, this fight that we're just now having, we haven't even mentioned the victim's name, Heather Hare, who died as a result of hatred. And I think it's really important to remind everyone why we're talking about this now. And if you thought or people thought that we were living in a post-racial world because we had a black president, welcome to reality. I think that's one thing that people forget is they say, oh, well, now, look, we have a black president. Look how great America is coming together. We are divided, and it's getting worse. I want to give you some idea about how we can very specifically look at what President Trump did not do, the words he did not use in the first 48 hours, and how that affected neo-Nazis, one of the most prolific, most well-known neo-Nazi. I want to read you what he said after the president came out with his initial statement. And if this doesn't tell you something, I don't know what will. Here is what the Daily Stormer, the guy that runs it, said. He said Trump's comments were good. He didn't attack us. He just said the nation should come together. Nothing specific against us. When asked to condemn, he just walked out of the room. Really, really good. God bless him. Those words are coming from a person who uses the most vile, disgusting, hateful, anti-Semitic, anti-black, you name it, misogynistic. He has gone after the victim in this case, and these are the words coming from him. That's how President Trump came off to those who believe in white supremacy. That is a major problem. Words matter. They matter to everyone who is listening to the president, and the fact that he waited a couple of days to actually name these groups and say, look, no to the KKK, no to neo-Nazis. We have to look at this as they look at it. They are taking as a signal that Trump is giving them a thumbs up.